Try to understand this land, Australia. Take her as she is, her moods, her mysteries. Mother of us all, beneath the Southern Cross, in her frame of peaceful seas. Try to understand this land, Australia. Take her as she is, her moods, her mysteries. Mother of us all, beneath the Southern Cross, in her frame of peaceful seas.
Norfolk Island, a speck of land in the vast South Pacific Ocean. Norfolk's cliffs are formidable, in most cases as unscalable as castle walls. They make the island a natural stronghold, and that's exactly what her first masters had in mind. For Norfolk's early settlers, unlike me, didn't come here by choice. They came in chains as convicts.
Ne plus ultra.
Last time I was here, I put my feelings about the worst of those days into a song. It describes a time when Norfolk Island became the ne plus ultra of jails, a living hell on earth.
You'll be flogged at Norfolk Island for all their worth.
You might get
300 lashes. At Norfolk they know how to flog.
Then they'll cut you
down and salt ya. Oh, they surely wouldn't do that to a mad dog.
For the triangles are ready, waiting, and the scourge is there, salivating, ready to strip the flesh from off your frames.
Every visitor to Norfolk has the same first impression. They've just discovered paradise. Once Norfolk's green valleys enfold you, it's hard to believe you're on an island at all. It's a storybook island. For the independent, a place with a magic way of life. For the tourist, a chance to explore somewhere real, yet at the same time, be everyone's guest.
Well, folks, if you ever get caught in the paddock with a bull, you race round the back and you grab his tail and you rub like hell. You'll see the blissful look come on his face, but whatever you do, don't let go. Keep on rubbing, because he'll finally settle down and you'll have a beautiful, placid animal.
The miracle is that with 30,000 visitors a year, tiny Norfolk still doesn't feel like a tourist resort. It's an island of natural smiles and open warmth.
Here you are, dear. Now, isn't that good, eh? Now you stand absolutely still. Don't you move. You know you're not to move when you've got people on you.
Norfolk does have some more practical attractions. Burnt Pine Shopping Centre pulls in the visitors because its goods are tax-free. You can buy French perfume or European designer clothes for a fraction of the mainland price. And islanders have the added bonus of paying no income tax and no local rates. There are other appealing things. It's a close-knit community where people have not forgotten how to help each other. Crime is virtually unheard of. People leave their keys in the car, nobody locks their front door. And when you go to make a local phone call, no coin slot. It's free. Although you do pay to post a local letter. Just 5 cents. Young people can ride a motorbike at 15, though they can't ride after 6 p.m. And one small point worth remembering in case you ever visit, cattle have right of way. In fact, the cattle do very well on Norfolk, and it's got little to do with the lush pasture. They're free to roam anywhere they wish on the island. They're the council's lawnmowers. Norfolk always has the appearance of a freshly mown golf course. All in all, a pretty nice place to be. This is one delightful way visitors can get into step with Norfolk's quieter pace. And how long is it since the horses were the mainstay of the transport here?
Right up in the early 50s, they start to disappear.
So you're the only one left?
I'm the only one left.
Last of his tribe, eh?
Last, yep.
I suppose you could call Colour Graham's wagon a tourist attraction. So it is. But it's more than that. If it's the timeless charm of the place that draws tourists here, that's also something islanders very much want to preserve for themselves. After all, this is their home.
Yeah, that rock down there, I nicknamed it myself. I call it the sleeping dog.
Oh, yeah.
It's one of my little specialties I show the tourists when they come along here. And
You can
swear it's a dog when you get a good look at it.
It's the same as your big black one.
Big black one,
Colour shows hundreds of visitors around his island, but they all ask him the same questions.
And they ask, you know, how many millionaires you have on the island. I said, oh, I think we have about 20.
That's apart from yourself.
And apart from yourself. Yeah. wishful thinking.
Yeah.
Yes, and how do they get here?
How can a tourist come to live here?
Well, you must get
asked that a lot, eh?
I do. I get asked, you know, how can they become permanent residents? I said, you can be my de facto or marry me.
Oh. Well, you know,
that's
take your choice.
Choice that if you're a woman.
But you are available.
I'm available at any ship.
It's over 200 years since the first white settlers arrived on Norfolk Island. In fact, they came all the way out here just weeks after founding Sydney in 1788.
I hereby claim this island in the name of King George III, his heir and successor.
The Governor Phillip! Governor Phillip!
So why, just a few weeks after the establishment of Sydney itself, would a handful of soldiers and convicts be sent to remote Norfolk Island? Politics, of course. There were always rumours about the French, but there were other good reasons. Norfolk Pines. It seems remarkable that tiny Norfolk should be the home of these unique giants. Most graceful when young, they change as they mature, but they keep their symmetry defying howling, salt-laden coastal winds. Captain Cook had been the first to see them and thought they'd make a perfect timber for ship's masts. The expedition of 1788 was sent to find out if Cook was right, but he was wrong. From the outside, they seem okay, but the big old trees can be rotten inside. No good for the masts of men of war. Mind you, in the worst of the convict days, one of these tree hollows really came into its own.
And escaped convict Barney Duffy made good use of the Norfolk pine. Living in a hollowed out tree like this one, he was able to evade capture, would you believe, for 7 years?
These days, Norfolk pine is selectively cut for local use only. And even the knots, more like carving stone than wood, are turned into beautiful craft objects. Without wood for ship's masts, the expedition of 1788 should have been a failure, and would have been but for one thing, the Norfolk soil. Norfolk's a natural hothouse, semi-tropical, even temperatures, even rainfall, and no frost. Things almost seem to grow before your eyes, making Norfolk a Garden of Eden. So deep and rich and fertile is Norfolk soil that in the first hungry years of white settlement in Australia, it was food from this remote island that kept Sydney from starving. In fact, the great attraction of Norfolk, even in convict days, was that the island was always able to feed itself. The buildings are not the only relics of convict days. These lovely Moreton Bay figs were planted in the 1830s. When this was part of a farm which grew enough produce to feed over 2,000 convicts. But man does not live by bread alone. By the 1830s, human imagination had managed to take this paradise of an island and turn it into a vision of hell.
On your left is the crank barrel. Now don't believe for a moment that this was only to grind meal for the settlement. The corn and maize was usually ground up at the water mill. Oh no, this crank mill was erected for the purpose of punishment for the poor devils in irons.
Under His Majesty's pleasure, Norfolk Island became a new kind of jail, a terror prison. Not meant to reform men, but to break them.
That gives us rest.
This is a reenactment, of course. Part of an unusual show acted out in the ruins of Kingston. But the horror was real, and it happened here.
It is one of my duties to keep stock of the tools that the convicts use in the fields and for cutting stone. Of course, some of them will attempt to chisel through their leg irons during the day, while they are out working. The guards will check the irons on each man wearing them, and if there has been any attempt to cut through, then that convict will be flogged.
92. For 30 terrible years, the lash was law, given not in dozens but hundreds at a time. One man during his stay received over 3,000 lashes, and that wasn't unusual.
100.
What became of prisoners on Norfolk no longer mattered, so long as enough horror stories leaked out to stop anyone else breaking the law. In the light of day, it's hard to imagine that this lovely setting, Norfolk's capital, Kingston, was once the most feared place in the South Pacific. But it was. For 30 years, these were the gates of hell. They should have carved above this arch, "Abandon hope, all ye who enter." There's not much left of the old main jail, but here, the worst offenders were crammed together in stifling, airless cells, often with hardly enough room to lie down. The whole island was a place of punishment. It was a life of constant hard labour, working fields, quarrying stone, making salt or lime at these lime kilns, all on near-starvation rations. But the most feared building was the crank mill. In here, men struggled to keep the giant grindstone turning. The wheel was unbalanced and often jammed, then lurched free, hacking shins and breaking legs. It was meant to break their spirits, but by tradition, men in here whistled, shouted, and cheered, just to show they weren't broken yet. Were they really all men beyond redemption? When I look at convict work like this, I find it hard to believe. Convict builders left a notable legacy, no less than the finest collection of Georgian buildings in the Southern Hemisphere. Works of tragic beauty, they show both craftsmanship and deep feeling. All too picturesque to be what they are, the legacy of men who worked in chains and lived in fear. Kingston was really built to last, and nothing illustrates that better than the strange underground watercourse known as the officers' baths. Actually, they're not baths at all, but part of a complex system of channels flushed by the sea at high tide, like something from ancient Rome. The drainage network extends under most of the main prison, so if killer diseases like dysentery ran wild in the jail itself, and they did, it wasn't because those in charge did not know any better. The houses in Quality Row are an obvious contrast to the stark life of the jail. In fact, that's your first impression. The staff of the prison, clerks and clergymen, officers and engineers, lived here in some comfort. But that may be too simple. Here's what one officer wrote before he left. Norfolk is a disfigured paradise. The clash of irons, the dull echo of the lash, fill my mind with horror and make my flesh creep. The system brutalized guards along with convicts. There are no traces of blood now on Bloody Bridge, but here, so they say, a half-crazed work party murdered their guard, hid his body within the wall, and were betrayed when blood dripped out across this stone. They were hanged for it, and they probably didn't care. It wasn't unknown for men to draw straws to see which one would kill the other. In that way, they'd both escape. One as the victim, the other when he swung from the rope. In the whole history of convict days, Norfolk saw only one humane commandant. He lived here in what is now the administrator's house. His name, Alexander McConachy, a true prison reformer. Ironically enough, McConachy was finally hounded out of office by public opinion. But his story also has an eerie twist. In fact, its echoes are still being heard today. McConachy encouraged music. He let a young convict teach his daughter to play the violin, and they took the lessons in here. It's said that they fell in love, but such star-crossed love could not be on Norfolk Island. The daughter was sent away in disgrace. The convict banished back to the prison. Nothing so strange about that, but official visitors to Norfolk Island insist that in this room they've heard the plaintive sound of a violin. Just kidding. But honestly, Norfolk's past guarantees that it has more than its fair share of ghost stories. Ghost stories. Mutiny was an ever-present fear. The soldiers' barracks are even better fortified than the jail itself. These walls were built to keep convicts out. If the guards had the guns, the prisoners always had the numbers. There were many mutinies. Most were bloody. All failed. The worst, in 1834, involved a young man of whom not much is known apart from his name, but to me, he stands for all the rest.
The early 1800s,
were very troubled times. There were many things the Irish did that Englishmen called crimes, from taking food to try to keep a family alive, to stealing guns to overthrow the tyrant. Londonderry Court, 1831. A 19-year-old boy's arraigned, the charge he stole a gun. Dominic McCoy was proven guilty by the court, and the judge pronounced that he would be transported. He said, "You'll know no joy, Mr. Dominic McCoy. The system has you beaten, you've been marked down as a failure. You'll be sent away with chains around your ankles, down to the hell they call Australia." In the Norfolk Island Mutiny of 1834, at daybreak all the convicts rushed, McCoy was in the fall. Such was their desperation to win their liberty, they fought with sticks against the soldiers' muskets. Of course it was a failure, not a single guard was killed, but it did relieve their boredom, so the soldiers were all thrilled. They dropped McCoy by Flagstaff Hill and rushed him for the fun, straight into him with their sharp bayonets. Chains around his ankles, down to the hell they call Australia. He was dragged across the cobblestones, blood gushing from his head. And 3 days later, poor young Dominic McCoy was dead. They chucked him in an unmarked grave, no one to mourn his loss, except his family keening back in Ireland. So in the absence of a tombstone to the memory of this boy, a song of mine's erected for Dominic McCoy, transported to Australia for the stealing of a gun, and cut to shreds by guards at Norfolk Island. Ironically, McCoy was considered lucky. Of the 29 remaining mutineers sentenced to hang, only 13 finally went to the gallows. They went dry-eyed. It was the 16 who were reprieved who wept bitter tears. This is Murderer's Mound, final resting place of the men executed after the mutiny. As usual, the hanging made little impact, but the decision of the commandant to bury the men out here, on unhallowed ground, chilled the convict community's soul. The reign of terror finally came to an end in 1854.
Oh.
You'll hear this hymn in only two places on Earth, Norfolk and even tinier Pitcairn Island. The two are linked by an extraordinary saga. If the last chapter in Norfolk's story was one of horror, the next is one of hope. The bounty story well enough. Led by Fletcher Christian, men yearning for freedom and lost Tahitian loves cast Captain Bligh adrift in an open boat. What happened next is less well known. The mutineers, their Tahitian wives, and six Tahitian men sailed the bounty to Pitcairn Island, scuttled her, and took up lonely refuge. Paradise didn't last. On tiny Pitcairn, the mutineers learned one familiar lesson, that isolation can breed violence, and their worst enemy proved to be the tyrant in themselves. In a few years, only one mutineer survived, Alexander Smith, a patriarch in an island of women and children. Smith decided to make a new beginning. He changed his own name to Adams and gave his people the Ten Commandments, carved into old ship's planks that may well have come from the bounty itself. If a bit rough-hewn, Adams' faith proved as sound as the bounty planks. 20 years after the mutiny, the Pitcairners were rediscovered. To the world's surprise, the children of reckless mutineers had become one of the most peaceful and law-abiding people on Earth.
There you are, it's one good, isn't it? What we cut there?
Yeah, we ought to get some of these Del Peckley. <Dylan Ron. laughs>
Too much sun on North Sydney.
If the same is said of Norfolk people, perhaps that's because nearly a third of them still trace their families back to Pitcairn, to Fletcher Christian, his fellow mutineers and their Tahitian wives. By the 1850s, the Pitcairners had outgrown their island. In 1856, at Queen Victoria's personal wish, they were offered a new home on Norfolk. At first, they lived much as they had on Pitcairn, resilient, self-sufficient people who'd turned their hand to whatever got them by. Right up to the 1960s, whaling kept the Norfolk economy going. The old whaling station is in ruins today, but in Pitcairn hymns, you can hear a slow rhythm designed for rowing. The whalers sang hymns as they rowed for shore. When they were late, women lit fires on the headland and sang their hunters home.
We can conclude this section of the service with the prayer of John Adams.
Pitcairners are still a simple, God-fearing people who draw their strength from an old Pitcairn prayer.
Suffer me not, O Lord, to waste this day in sin or folly, but let me worship thee with much delight. Teach me to know more of thee and to serve thee better than ever I have done before.
Teach me, for know more about you and for serve you better than hour I been before. So I'll be fetter for lowing him, side worship and in serving you as for hour more. Amen.
You could call Alice Buffett custodian of the least known language in the world, Pitcairner.
Oh, I could you laugh with what were you? I tell you, I hope it's our good kind. And what thing all you yen are doing?
She's part scholar, part apostle.
Oh, well, you know, going fishing.
Keeping the language alive has been an uphill battle.
In my father's generation, they would have to write out 300 times after school, I must not speak gibberish at school. And then in my generation, one would have to write out either 30 or 50 times, I must not talk Norfolk at school, which is difficult when it is our mother tongue.
Ours, Mum.
Ours, Mum.
When Papa hire.
When Papa hire.
These days, the Pitcairn language is encouraged.
Right, now, you only think about when you only go down on a scene, and we'll think about some of them thing we used to do down there. Zane.
You go snorkeling and I try a bite.
What did them try a bite?
They like meat.
The meat on
I must admit I find the language beautiful to listen to. A lyrical mixture of 18th century English tinged with Tahitian.
Now when they meant ask you only tell something, you only had to talk out loud in a loud voice so he knew a thing you only telling.
Tell us again.
I mean to go surfing this day, but I have a go down tennis.
Even though their language is staging a comeback, Pitcairners and their culture still face a challenge. Today, they represent less than one-third of the total population of Norfolk Island. But in the end, everyone on Norfolk, Pitcairner or not, is in the same boat. As perfect as this setting is, Norfolk is still a tiny island and a long way from anywhere. And that affects every aspect of life here.
You're tuned to 2NI Radio on Norfolk Island. On a lighter note, would the person or persons who took 14 bags of cement from the block factory please return them? And just reminding Lightridge workers, the motor vessel Capitaine Wallace is due to commence unloading this morning at 7:30 at Kingston.
When the boat comes in about once a month, part-time lighter men drop whatever they're doing to help. It's not unusual for islanders to have two or even three jobs, but none are more important than this. The cargo ship is Norfolk's lifeline. Watching this operation, it's not hard to cast your imagination back 100 years. Apart from motors in the boats, very little has changed. Norfolk has no natural harbour. It does have two precarious wharves, one on either side of the island. Which one they use depends on the weather. It's a dangerous job, particularly if the sea decides to mount a sneak attack. A new car, fridge, or lounge isn't something you can buy on impulse. You need to think and order months ahead. Island life is a great leveller. You can't buy your way out of a shortage. Someone said to me, it doesn't matter how rich you are here. If there's no flour in the shop, there's no flour. Maybe there's something we can learn from islands. The bigger a continent, the easier it is to think that someone else will solve your problem. The smaller an island, the more obvious it becomes that you have to solve it yourself. Take conservation, for instance. That's vital in such a tiny place. And in fact, Norfolk has an object lesson on its doorstep. Two 200 years ago, barren Phillip Island was as lush as Norfolk. But back in convict days, game was turned loose to make a hunting reserve. Pigs, goats and rabbits reigned unchecked. Phillip Island became a wasteland. Today, after a major eradication program, plant life is slowly coming back. One day it may return to something like its natural state. Meanwhile, the need for conservation is never out of sight. Even on Norfolk, many species have already been lost. Ranger John Hicks has the job to see that they don't lose any more. Currently, one of the most endangered is Norfolk's unique green parrot. Once, they were prolific. Now they're down to just a few pairs, and they're being looked after with enormous care.
Back in the box, mate. We'll grab it. We'll do weights from there. Oh, there we go. 32 in the wild. So you're looking at a population of the order of 40 to 50 birds. It's highly endangered. And there's a shortage of nesting trees too, because some of the best trees for nesting, the ones that had good hollows, were also had very durable timber, and they were favoured for fence posts. So there's a shortage of nesting hollows in the wild.
People have always managed to get by on Norfolk, but isolation has made money hard to earn.
I know who's doing all the work, Kevin.
Yeah, the middle one.
Just lately, it's a different story. Partly thanks to a remarkable crop they call green gold. Kentia palms aren't native to Norfolk, but they say they germinate here better than anywhere else in the world. And that's Norfolk's good luck, because in the last few years, Kentias have become the world's most popular indoor palm.
Got a good hold on that bunch, have you said?
Yeah, it's a big bunch here.
Well, I can take the ladder away, can I?
You want me to come down in a hurry?
And how high is this tree now, the one you're on?
This tree to the seed would be about 50 feet.
Goodness me. How old?
In true island fashion, Sid Cooper also has three jobs. Sid works at the airport by day, his restaurant at night, and I'm not too sure when he and his partner Kevin Williams get the time to run the Kentia export business.
You might need a hard hat down there. In a
That's what I was thinking. So what's the value, Kev?
Well, those zarprons there at head worth $50.
Goodness me. Got to be $1,000 worth, isn't there?
Yes, it'd be $1,000 there.
Looks pretty easy to me. What do you reckon?
Going pretty easy.
Huh?
Yep.
Give a mainlander a go.
Okay, mate, off you go.
$1,000 a tree, you little beauty. Hello. From the top. Right up in the front on the tree?
Yeah, well.
How about that?
Yeah.
God. Get your heart out now, Nicky.
Kentias have been a local bonanza, bringing in $1 million a year, over a third of the total export income. Judging by the number of young trees, a lot more people hope to benefit in the future. Some islanders call them their pension fund, and hopefully they will be. Right up to the 1970s, Pitcairners and a few late settlers had the island much to themselves for 100 years. Today it's a different story. The tourist explosion, 30,000 visitors a year, puts a lot of pressure on an island with a permanent population of about 2,000 people. It worries many islanders I know that their culture and way of life may not survive. But I think it will. For one thing, even newer settlers have come here in search of the same values Pitcairners have always prized: the freedom and independence of Norfolk's traditional way of life. People like John and June Rives.
We decided to come to Norfolk, my wife and I, because we found that in the life we were leading, it was rapidly getting to the stage where you couldn't relate to people. And I felt that what we ought to do is get to a place where values... gradually, in Australia, we found that we were reliant on government instrumentalities. You had regulations for this and regulations for that. So we felt we were going to go to an environment where we had some control over our own destinies. And we thought, well, we're going to have our fuel stove, we're going to cut our own wood for the fuel stove, we're going to have our own generator, and when we decide that we want something, we can go ahead and do it for ourselves rather than rely on somebody else to do it.
And now for a trick question. Is Norfolk part of Australia? Well, partly yes, but mainly no. Norfolk's independence is based on doubts about what kind of rights Queen Victoria gave to the Pitcairners back in 1856. It's a question that both sides have been wise enough not to resolve. And that's part of the magic. In an increasingly bureaucratic world, Norfolk hasn't been forced into someone else's mould. Just as Norfolk flies two flags, so there are two special days on their calendar. Sentimentally, Bounty Day is the most significant. This is when Pitcairners celebrate their arrival on Norfolk Island. For the old Norfolk families, it's a chance to show pride in their special heritage and perhaps to remind newcomers that Norfolk was their home first. Foundation Day celebrates the first landing of 1788, the moment when a tiny island afloat in the mid-Pacific changed course forever. Norfolk's an island with two flags, two pasts, even two peoples. But few places I know have been so successful in blending such pressures into a complete whole. A place where Pitcairners, new settlers and tourists feel equally at home. Now for the bad news. You can't come and live here. Well, not unless you're very lucky. In the last couple of years, strict new residency controls had to be introduced to save Norfolk from bursting at the seams. But you can visit a place that at first you think you'll see in a day. In fact, you can't get to know Norfolk in a week. Some would say a lifetime.
Which just leaves one question. Will you come in this day or morla? Are you coming today or tomorrow?
Try to understand this land, Australia. Take her as she is, her moods, her mysteries. Mother of us all, beneath the Southern Cross, in her frame of peaceful seas. Try to understand this land, Australia. Take her as she is, her moods, her mysteries. Mother of us all,